This episode of Real Engineering is brought to you by Skillshare, home to over 20,000 classes that could teach you a new life skill. Staring at the sky in awe is one of the few quintessential human experiences. Gazing into the vast emptiness of space, wondering where our place in the universe stands. For millennia, the mystery of these celestial bodies captivated the human mind, seeding religions and mythical stories. We couldn't ignore the moon above us, influencing our tides, or the sun, our benevolent provider, burning in the blue sky. At night, individual stars melded together into a boundless blanket of glittering light, until we began to notice patterns in their chaos, guiding us as we explored our world. These star maps helped us make a monumental discovery. Some stars in the sky move differently to others. Wandering through the night sky, planets like ours orbiting our sun, Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn, all visible to the naked eye, were discovered this way by ancient Babylonian astronomers over 4,000 years ago. Later, Galileo improved the telescope, allowing him to observe even fainter points in the sky, invisible to the naked eye. He discovered Jupiter's moons, Ganymede, Callisto, Io, and Europa, and Saturn's moons soon followed, mostly discovered by Cassini. Uranus and Neptune had been observed numerous times through telescopes, but astronomers continuously mistook them for stationary stars or comets. It was only when astronomers noticed the circular orbit of Uranus that it was accepted as a planet. Then, as its orbit was further examined, astronomers noticed deviations that could only be caused by a nearby planet, and thus Neptune, our solar system's final planet, was discovered. It took thousands of years to just discover the planets in our solar system, but in the last 30 years, we've discovered over 3,717 planets orbiting stars so far away that we will never be able to visit them with current technology. Perhaps the most fascinating planetary system we have discovered is that of TRAPPIST-1, an ultra-cool dwarf star located 40 light-years away from our sun, which has not only one temperate terrestrial planet, but seven. Each of the planets are rocky and between the size of Earth and Mars. The star is small and cold compared to ours, but the planets orbit so closely to the star, closer than Mercury orbits the Sun, that they all have the possibility of containing liquid water. This is a lot of information about planets that we can't even see directly. So how do present-day astronomers find these, relatively speaking, tiny objects floating in space? The first planets discovered orbiting the star were discovered by a Belgian team using the TRAPPIST-South telescope, located high in the Chilean mountains. The team had their telescope trained on the dwarf star, waiting for a dimming of its light, a telltale sign of a planet in orbit passing in front of the star, and thus blocking some of its light. But how have we discovered so much about this system simply by a dimming of light in its star? If we calculate the distance to the star using the parallax method, we can discover a lot more about the planets passing in front of it. You can see how the parallax method works right now by holding your thumb in front of you with one eye open. Now close that eye and open the other. Did you notice it appeared to move relative to the background? This is called the parallax method, and we can use it to measure the distance to the star. But instead of closing our eyes and staring at the sky, we can take measurements of the planet's position from opposite sides of our orbit around the sun. We know the distance between these two points, and we can measure the change in the star's position relative to the distant stars behind it, giving us the parallax angle. Thus, we have all the information we need to calculate the distance to the star using some simple trigonometry. Now that we know the distance to the star, we can calculate its mass and size by observing its apparent brightness and temperature observed from Earth. We have models for how stars form, with massive stars being hotter and brighter than smaller stars. And so by measuring these values, we can get a lot of information about the star. That's how we know TRAPPIST-1 is an ultra-cool dwarf star. Now that we know more about the star, we can discover what we are really interested in: the planet's size, mass, and whether it resides in the Goldilocks zone where humans could survive. To do that, we need to know how far away the planet is from the star. We do this using Kepler's third law, which looks like this. It tells us the orbital period for the planet. That's how long it takes to orbit its star. Here, G is Newton's gravitational constant, capital M is the star's mass, lowercase m is the planet's mass, and A is the orbital radius. We can ignore the planet's mass for now, as it's minuscule compared to the star's. If we do this for Earth, it introduces an error of just 0.001%. The period is measured by seeing the time between transits, and so we have all the variables we need to calculate the orbital radius. Now that we know how far away the planet is, figuring out its diameter from the transit dimming is simple. The next bit of information gathering requires a bit of a perspective shift. We are used to the idea that planets orbit a star, But it would be more accurate to say that the planet and star orbit the center of mass of the star-planet system, which is not at the center of the star. This means the planet's mass is actually impacting the orbit of the star around this point. The larger the mass of the planet, the larger the deviation. We can measure the magnitude of this deviation by detecting the Doppler shift in the star's light frequency. As the star moves towards us, the light becomes slightly more blue, and when the star moves away from us, it becomes slightly more red. Using the law of conservation of momentum, we can easily calculate the mass of the planet. We know the velocity of the planet from the orbital radius and period measurements, the mass of the star from our distance and luminosity measurements, and the velocity of the sun is measured from these Doppler shifts in the light frequency, leaving us with all the information we need to calculate the mass of the planet. Using these tools, astronomers have inferred quite a lot of information about these planets. The seven planets orbit so closely to their star that a year ranges from just 1.5 days for the innermost planet to 20 days for the outermost planet. They are so close packed that the planets will at times appear in each other's sky, larger than our moon appears in ours. Maybe the coolest part of the entire thing is the planetary system is named after the beer the scientists used to toast their discovery. But it isn't all good news. Because they orbit so close, many of the planets will be tidally locked, like our moon is to the Earth, meaning once side of the planet will constantly face the sun, which may restrict life to the Terminator, the narrow band of perpetual twilight. On top of this, orbiting this closely to a dwarf star exposes it to radiation from solar flares, which can strip its atmosphere away, especially if it is not protected by a strong magnetic field like Earth. For now, we don't have a lot of information on these planets beyond their position, period, and mass, but we'll know more soon as the James Webb Telescope will be able to give us more information about the atmosphere on these planets by observing the light that shines through their atmosphere during transit. By examining the spectrum of light coming through the atmosphere, we can discover what gases are in its atmosphere. Here we have the analysis of Venus, Earth, and Mars. All have the fingerprints of carbon dioxide in their atmosphere, while only Earth has the traits of an atmosphere rich in ozone and water. If we see results like this coming from any of the TRAPPIST-1 planets, a worldwide toast with Belgian beers may be in order. Learning how astronomers discover our universe is fascinating, but it's unlikely you will ever have the tools to discover your own worlds. But you can explore the world you stand on and its nighttime sky using fairly inexpensive equipment to produce incredible photos like this. You can learn how to do this using this course on Skillshare, which will teach you how to find the best times of month to plan your shoot, how to find dark areas in your location, how to identify and plan the stars you'll photograph, and how to set up your equipment. This is probably my favorite course I've ever taken on Skillshare to date, and I bet you will like it too. These days you can teach yourself pretty much any skill online, and Skillshare is a fantastic place to do it. With professional and understandable classes that follow a clear learning curve, you can dive in and start learning how to do the work you love. A premium membership begins around $10 a month for unlimited access to all courses, but the first 1,000 people to sign up with this link will get their first 2 months for free. So ask yourself right now, what skill have you been putting off learning? What project have you been dreaming of completing but you aren't sure if you have the skills to do it? Why not start right now and sign up to Skillshare using the link below to get your first 2 months free? You have nothing to lose and a valuable life skill to gain. As usual, thanks for watching and thank you to all my Patreon supporters. If you'd like to see more from me, the links to my Twitter, Facebook, Discord server, subreddit, and Instagram pages are below.